Hi, Rebecca.
Hi, Jim. How are you?
Hey, how you been? You're wintering well out there?
Oh, well, yes. And, you know, luckily we're dang near, let's see here. Oh, wait. Okay.
Okay, so I think we are recording and have everyone now, if I have that correct.
Yes.
Well, we'll go ahead and get started then. Welcome everyone who's out there joining us, and thanks for hopping on this virtual presentation this evening about the Swan River National Wildlife Refuge Wetland Restoration Project. I'm Luke Lamar, the Conservation Director at Swan Valley Connections. And if you're not familiar with Swan Valley Connections, we're a conservation and education nonprofit organization based here in the beautiful Swan Valley, whose mission is to inspire conservation and expand stewardship in the Swan Valley. We do a lot of different things. Some of that entails working a lot with private landowners to help with forest stewardship projects, to reduce wildfire risk and improve forest health, to helping folks secure their various bear attractants to minimize bear conflicts. And we also have a private land stream and wetland restoration program in partnership with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service's Partners for Fish and Wildlife program. In addition, we work closely with our public land and wildlife management agencies to help expand their capacity. One example is we've been working with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service Refuges program since 2015. On the Swan River National Wildlife Refuge Wetland Restoration Project Assessment and Design, which we will be presenting on here this evening. Myself and Swan Valley Connections are extremely excited to be a part of this large-scale wetland restoration project that will restore over 600 acres of ditched and drained wetlands, and to be helping with outreach to help folks get informed here tonight. In 2015, I had the pleasure of getting to know the refuge fairly intimately, along with our then executive director and expert botanist Maria Mantis, by mapping vegetation communities across the entire refuge. Along with that effort, I found out that I'm pretty allergic to reed canary grass when it's pollinating, and we'll get into why that invasive grass is disliked from an ecological standpoint, not just my immune system's disdain for it here in a little while. I've also had the distinct pleasure of writing a $1 million North American Wetlands Conservation Act grant to help fund this project, which has been recommended for funding. So that's also super exciting to be a part of the team working on this really cool project. Before we get started, I wanted to cover a couple of housekeeping items. This event will be recorded and available on Swan Valley Connections webpage in case you want to review certain parts of the presentation again or share with friends later. We won't answer questions until following the presentation, but there will be plenty of time to address them then. And if you have a question, you can type those into the Q&A box, which you can access at the bottom panel of your screen. Please don't type questions into the chat box, as we won't be monitoring that for questions. And we have several partners who you can see on your screen who are here to either present or answer questions at the end. So I'm going to introduce everyone here. We have Salida Amont, who is a restoration ecologist for Whitefish-based River Design Group, which you're, if you're not familiar with that firm, they have established themselves as one of the leading river and wetland restoration consulting firms in the Pacific Northwest. Along with Salida is Nate Wyatt, who is the project engineer for River Design Group. And also with us, we have Jim Lang with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, who is the refuge manager for the Swan River National Wildlife Refuge. And Ben Gillis, who is also with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and the project leader for the Western Montana National Wildlife Refuge Complex. Because we have so many panelists, once the PowerPoint presentation begins, if you don't want to see any of our faces or the boxes on your screen, you can minimize those by clicking various tabs in the upper right corner of your screen. And with that, I will turn it over to Jim for an introduction to the Swan River National Wildlife Refuge and the Wetland Restoration Project.
Well, hi, everybody. Thanks for joining tonight. I'll just jump right into it. Swan River National Wildlife Refuge is one of seven refuges, which is managed by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service within the Western Montana Complex, which is headquartered out of Great Falls, Montana. The complex encompasses 13 counties on both sides of the Continental Divide. Swan River National Wildlife Refuge is located on the south end of Swan Lake and approximately 36 miles southeast of Kalispell. The refuge was first purchased back in 1973 and is approximately 2,000 acres in size. And the refuge purpose is for the management of migratory birds. So we'll move to the next slide. So the groundwork for this project actually probably first started back in 2013 with LIDAR flights. LIDAR flights are basically aerial elevation data, which we use to inventory the extent of the ditching and the levees that were occurring on the refuge. Then moving forward in 2015 and 16, a high definition vegetation mapping was conducted by Swan Valley Connections. In 2017, ground and surface water monitoring was conducted by River Design Group. And then in 2018, River Design Group presented us with the Wetland Restoration Assessment Report. In 2020, we submitted for a NACA grant, hopefully to secure some funding for the actual work. And just recently in 2021, we received word that that grant is going to go forward and we will likely be funded for this. So it's nice to have some money to actually do the work. The objectives, restoring the wetland hydrology and the native vegetation community on the refuge. Restoring the hydrology will promote conversion of reed canary grass, which is a highly invasive plant, and promote the native plant community to come back. So that's what we're looking to do. This will in turn improve habitat for wildlife-dependent wildlife species. Also, the project is going to improve access for our visitors on the refuge, which is something that we've needed to do for a long time. Luke?
All right, thanks, Jim. As you can see from this aerial image, the Swan River National Wildlife Refuge consists of a large wetland complex that contains a variety of diverse wetland types and vegetation communities. In fact, it's the largest wetland complex in the Swan Valley, which despite having over 4,000 wetlands and 16% surface water in the Swan here, we're still largely a forested landscape. And so the Swan Refuge is a unique piece of habitat of open wetland types, even here in the Swan, despite our abundant wetlands. The refuge is 1,979 acres in size, most of which are wetlands or riparian forests. And as you can see on the map there, the image, the Swan River flows through the refuge and into Swan Lake at the northern end. And there are refuge lands on both sides, on the east and west side of the river. And surrounding the refuge are a mix of U.S. Forest Service lands and private properties as well. The proposed restoration actions would take place only on the Swan Refuge, the adjacent Cruz waterfowl production area, and a small chunk of U.S. Forest Service lands that are labeled there. If we zoom in a little bit on that aerial image, you can see natural old river channels and oxbows, but also the extensive network of ditches and levees that are found out there currently. Jim just mentioned that LIDAR imagery or that LIDAR data, which is a remote sensing method. You can easily see all the straight lines are the ditches and levees that have altered that natural hydrology of many of the wetlands on the refuge. And as you can see in this photo, the Swan Refuge is extremely flat with only several feet of elevation difference from the southern end of the refuge to the northern end at Swan Lake. And prior to being established as a refuge in 1973, it had extensive history of alterations, anything from logging camps on or adjacent to the refuge from 1914 to 1919. It actually had in the late 1920s, the largest muskrat fur farm in America was on the refuge property, which ended up failing during the Great Depression. And later it was extensively ditched and drained by homesteaders to facilitate hay production and livestock grazing. Many homesteaders during this era also planted timothy and the invasive reed canary grass and potentially other non-native grasses as well. This photo shows one of the primary ditches that conveys water from the southern end of the refuge north to Swan Lake. And these photos show some of the levees and ditch systems that are in place today. These levees or large berms consist of the soil that was originally where the ditches are now, and that will be utilized to put back in the ditch systems as plugs to restore the natural hydrology as part of this project. The result of these manipulations has dried the wetlands to varying degrees across the refuge, making them vulnerable to colonization and spread of non-native species, particularly reed canary grass. And this is just another quick photo along the major levee and ditch system that conveys water west and then north towards Swan Lake. And if you go out on the refuge later in the summer, certain parts of the refuge, particularly areas that receive seasonal flooding and where the water table recedes below the ground, this invasive reed canary grass does very well and can form dense monocultures that can completely choke out and outcompete native wetland vegetation for water, sunlight, and oil and soil nutrients. Across the refuge, 311 acres were mapped by Swan Valley Connections in 2015 as complete reed canary grass monocultures, and 820 acres of the refuge have some percentage of reed canary grass in them. In many areas, the altered wetland hydrology from being ditched and drained has resulted in some areas drying out and has benefited the reed canary grass colonization and spread. By plugging ditches to restore the natural hydrology and keeping the water table higher throughout the year, reed canary grass can essentially be drowned out and will passively return to native vegetation such as sedges and rushes. And Salito will talk more about the assessment of the refuge and the science behind this, but the project's actions are expected to restore the hydrology of approximately 609 acres of wetlands and convert approximately 394 acres of reed canary grass infestations back to native vegetation. When we did the vegetation mapping surveys, we also discovered several patches of the highly invasive Phragmites australis, or commonly known as European common reed grass. In these several small patches, we found 2.71 acres of Phragmites, which in Montana are listed as a priority 1A noxious weed species. This listing essentially means that they are the highest priority for prevention, education, and eradication. And when detected, in this case, eradication is the most cost-effective strategy for managing this high priority species. So this restoration project aims to completely remove these patches of Phragmites through physical or chemical removal before they spread any further. So that's a little background on the refuge. And now I'll turn it over to Salita, who will discuss the assessment and design of the project in further detail. So I am going to stop sharing my screen real quick, and Salita is gonna start sharing hers. There we go.
Great. Thanks for that introduction, Luke. So like we previously mentioned, in 2017, we performed the landscape scale assessment of the refuge, primarily through the use of that high resolution LIDAR elevation data set that was collected back in 2013. What we found was a drastically altered landscape, just littered with these old wetland drainage ditches and associated berms and a few levees. We categorized these ditches into three different priorities. Priority one ditches are shown here in red, and those total 5.17 miles of wetland drainage ditch. And these are fairly substantial, 2 to even 4 feet deep ditches that hold water even during the dry season out here in the Swan. The priority two ditches in yellow total 6.35 miles in length. However, they're much more minimal, approximately 1 foot on average in depth, and don't really alter the hydrology, especially seeing as most of them run into these or drain into these primary ditches. And then we found some priority three ditches. These are barely noticeable on the landscape, but it was interesting to inventory them in any case. So we really focused on, the ditch network that we saw was actively, holding water as well as conveying it downslope from the refuge into Swan Lake. Like we mentioned earlier, there was a few levees that we want to eradicate as well. This levee A, it's on an old oxbow meander of the Swan River, and it does restrict overland flow, when the Swan River is flooding, to the refuge. So this levee B to the south of it, it's much more minimal. It doesn't really affect the hydrology. This levee C, it's not labeled here, but it's on the south shore of Swan Lake. And it's definitely a very noticeable man-made feature, and it does restrict some overland flow of water from Swan Lake to the refuge. We also have these three smaller ditches here on the northwest corner of the refuge that drain these wetlands directly into the Swan River. So when we're talking about wetland restoration hydrology, we definitely wanted to, get the most benefit out of the project, especially knowing the cost of major earthwork operations. We decided to look further, look at these priority one ditches. And if you look at the slope of especially the primary one and primary four, which this primary one is the main south to north running ditch through here. And then this primary four runs east to west and north and empties into Swan Lake. These two are the only ones that actually have any slope to them. So they collect the water and then they actively convey it downslope and out of refuge wetlands. This primary two and primary three, they're definitely deep and significant ditches, but they basically just hold the water. They don't move it anywhere. So with the cost benefit ratio and analysis that we did, we decided to, definitely focus our efforts on primary one and primary four. Three alternatives were in the environmental assessment and evaluated. So alternative A is the no action alternative. So basically no restoration actions would take place. The ditches would continue to convey water out of refuge wetlands, and the reed canary grass populations would continue to thrive. Alternative B is our proposed action alternative, which I'll go into much greater detail. And then alternative C was another alternative that we evaluated. So jumping to the alternative B proposed action, which we are the most interested in. This proposed action would fill the main drainage ditches to the greatest extent possible using all the available material on site to restore the wetland hydrology. So it's important to note that, over the years, a lot of that material has been eroded away. And what we are left with is 25,000 cubic yards of earthen material available in those original ditch spoil berms, as well as the flood levees that we want to remove. And that translates to approximately 5,000 feet of drainage ditch fill that we can accomplish on the site. With this ditch fill and restoration of wetland hydrology, we do anticipate a passive reduction of those re-canary grass populations in favor of native desirable wetland vegetation. And I'll go through that in much more detail in a few slides here. Like Luke was saying, we'll have active removal of the invasive Phragmites, both physically and chemically, and then have some site access and parking area improvements for the refuge. So this is the end product of the alternative B, the proposed action. So you see these black areas are the berm and levee excavation areas. All that will go into these strategic ditch plug locations here in red. It is important to note that, I'll get into the temporary access roads a little later. Sorry about that. So going to alternative C really quickly, this was also evaluated. It's everything in the alternative B, proposed action alternative, as well as filling the entire length of those two main ditches that can actively convey the water out of the wetlands. So the total length of those two ditches is 2.7 miles and a total volume of about 76,000 cubic yards of material would be needed to completely fill those wetlands. I mean, not fill those wetlands, fill the drainage ditches that drain the wetlands. So that extra volume that we need, which is about 50,000 cubic yards of material, would be sourced from a new wetland excavation area out of current upland areas that's currently just a re-canary grass monoculture. But it's important to note that the level of wetland hydrology restoration that can occur with alternative, you know, C, it's the same as the alternative B proposed action. So we can gain the same level of wetland hydrology restoration from alternative B as this more expensive alternative C. This is just a figure showing the fill generation area down here, and this, along with all the berms and levees that I talked about earlier, would go to fill this entire primary one and primary four ditch. Here you can also see those Phragmites australis removal areas. This area right by this levee C would be physically removed along with the earthwork operations. And then these more distinct patches in the middle of these areas would be chemically removed. And this is for the proposed action alternative as well. So let's jump back to the alternative B proposed action. So again, filling the main drainage ditches to the greatest extent possible using all the available on-site material. We would also improve that access from Highway 83. I don't know if you guys have been there recently, but it's about a 30-foot turning radius to go into the main refuge turnoff. We want to increase that to a 60-foot turning radius, and that's to accommodate the large trucks that are needed for the construction, as well as, you know, that'll stay in perpetuity and it'll be a safer environment to turn into the actual refuge there. And then we'll also improve that parking area to a 60-foot turning radius from the existing 30-foot turning radius. So to accommodate the restoration actions in alternative B, we are looking at establishing 5.4 miles of temporary access roads within the refuge. But the vast majority here, 4.7 miles, are on dry access roads. So the tops of berms and levees that we're going to be removing anyway as part of the project. And to gain for the machinery to gain access for those on those roads, they'll just have to level the tops of them to make them drivable. We are going to be crossing saturated ground for about 3,000 feet, which includes the import of fabric, some fabric and pit run fill material, but this will be removed and those roads will be completely reclaimed at the end of the project. Then we have an additional 860 feet of ditch plug access road, which that's where machinery has to get across actual, you know, deep ditch areas. And this includes the import of some logs as well as pit run fill material. And they'll be, you know, at the end, they'll be topped with sod and they will stay in place as part of the project. And then again, we have 2.71 acres of physical and chemical phragmites grass removal. So here's an example of a plan set sheet design sheet. We're looking at primary four right now. So the main east to west running ditch. And you can see these brown areas are berm excavation areas. You can see the dotted line here is the temporary access road that we'll use. These white areas are the ditch plugs, ditch fills. And then these blue areas are constructed temporary access roads. They'll be deconstructed. These red areas are ditch plug access roads and they'll stay in place. Real quickly, here's an example of a grading plan, same location. We're looking at three plus feet of cut out of some of these berm areas, and then 3 or more feet of fill in these deepest ditch locations. And it's important to note, so this is a detail of a ditch and ditch fill and berm removal. You can see the berm removal here, ditch fill in the middle. And it's important to note that we will be filling the ditch to about 1 foot above the finished ground surface with general fill and then and as well as sod. And that is to allow for settling. And so when we do remove these berms, we will be stockpiling the existing sod and then reusing that sod back on these berm removal surfaces as well as on the ditch plugs. And anywhere where we don't have enough sod to cover the whole area, we'll be seeding with a native seed mix. So let's move forward from the design aspects and talk a little bit more about the vegetation and why we really think that this restoration of wetland hydrology will result in a reduction in reed canary grass throughout the refuge. So like Luke said, you know, there was a very large wetland, you know, vegetation mapping effort. Well, not only the wetlands, but uplands as well. They did map, like Luke said, 311 acres of reed canary grass monoculture. And that's shown here in the bright yellow. There's also other sedge marsh, other herbaceous marsh, shrubland and forest are shown in the green. But it's very important to note, like Luke said, we also have reed canary grass in some percentage throughout the vast majority of area in the refuge. 820 acres of refuge land. On top of the 311 acres of reed canary grass monoculture have some percentage of reed canary grass. So these areas with the hatching to the right show areas with over 50% reed canary grass in these other, you know, native wetland populations. And the hatching to the left are areas with less than 50% reed canary grass. So as was mentioned before, we also installed a groundwater monitoring network throughout the refuge, I think back in 2017. And so far we have 1 year of data that we analyzed. I believe this was water year 2018, going from September through September. And you can see this is groundwater elevations relative to the ground surface for all of these sites together. So you can see this groundwater six is the most northerly location, and it's the lowest in elevation here, closest to the lake. And then of interest is also this groundwater 7 and groundwater 8. They tend to have the highest groundwater elevations throughout the year. And then as we move to groundwater 9 and 10, they tend to be on the lower end, according to the elevation analysis is understandable. But it's interesting to know, I believe that 2018 was kind of a high water year, but it's very, very impressive that the groundwater level for this groundwater 6 site close to the Swan Lake, the water was above the ground surface for a vast majority of the year from November 1 all the way to August. And if we're looking at groundwater, I was looking at groundwater 8. Right here. But the same pattern is true for groundwater 6. As we move south, this groundwater 10, the driest site, the groundwater stays about a foot below the ground surface for the majority of that same period and only rises to the ground surface around April and May. So you can really see the difference between this southern and northern locations here. So going further in our vegetation analysis, we were really interested in why we had these, reed canary grass monoculture populations surrounded by areas of native wetland sedges, rushes, and horsetail communities. Or conversely, why were these great, horsetail and sedge communities with no reed canary grass surrounded by 100% reed canary grass? So this transect 13, again, this is at the northerly location close to Swan Lake. It has the highest groundwater level. We see no reed canary grass right around 3071 and 3072 feet in elevation. We bump that up even a half a foot to 1 foot, but even at a 1/2 foot bump in elevation, we run into 100% reed canary grass monoculture. Again, drop down, there's no reed canary grass, bump up, a foot here, there's 100% reed canary grass. And so this was pretty extreme in that there was no mixing of the reed canary grass into these other wetland communities. So next we'll look at transect number 11 and transect number 8. So with 11 kind of towards the middle of the refuge, or the middle of the northern part of the refuge, we see some mixing of the communities here. So again, 100% reed canary grass monocultures at the highest locations. You drop down a half a foot to a foot, you get 60% reed canary grass, 40% horsetail, and you drop down another half a foot, the reed canary grass completely drops out. Same thing with this transect 8. We have a lot more mixing here between the sedge community with no reed canary grass and the and I believe this is a berm area. Yep, right there. And the berm area with 100% reed canary grass. And so this wide swath of land had, 60% reed canary grass, 40% pasture grass and sedge. So it's very interesting to note that, especially, in the areas with very high groundwater throughout a majority of the year, you get these very distinct differences between, areas where the reed canary grass completely basically gets drowned out compared to, they have a little bit of air to work with and it's not completely saturated for the whole year. So when we started plotting up these beneficial effects to the wetlands, and now we're talking about areas where we have established that we will get some recanary grass reduction in favor of an increase in desirable wetland vegetation. We're looking at this area, you know, and we're mapping that at approximately 400 acres of area. And so if you think back to the vegetation map where these are sedge and rush and horsetail communities with some percentage of recanary grass in them. But the native component is already there. If we can just increase that groundwater level a nominal 1 foot, we do believe that we should be able to drop a lot of that recanary grass out of those communities. You know, we don't predict that, you know, down here in the very, you know, southern portions of refuge wetlands where we have like these huge recanary grass monocultures. You know, we don't predict that, you know, even with this area having groundwater level increase, the recanary grass populations probably won't drop off as much as here. In the north because of those groundwater levels. If you remember the elevation relative to the ground, we're looking at this, you know, groundwater 10 area. It doesn't really get above the ground surface currently much at all. So that one foot increase, it's gonna bump it up, but yeah, we're not anticipating that area to convert by any means. Again, the area of groundwater level increase 655 acres compared to the area with recanary grass reduction. And it's important to note that, you know, we understand it's not going to be a complete elimination of recanary grass through these areas, but we do believe that it's going to be a pretty significant reduction in recanary grass occurrence. Along those lines, let's look at a couple success stories where we have you know, restored wetland hydrology. One of them is Lost Trail National Wildlife Refuge, and another is McGregor Meadows WPA, which is not labeled here, but it's circled right here. And these are just west of Kalispell. So first, the McGregor Meadows WPA, it was restored in 2012. Wetland drainage ditches were plugged. Two streams were raised to floodplain elevation, and this essentially restored groundwater levels in a previously ditched wetland environment, much like we are planning to do at Swan. Here at the top, we see the 2011 wetland delineation, which occurred a year before the restoration. We had 327 acres of recanary grass. This wasn't monoculture, but it was, you know, it was more monoculture over here to the west, but all of this black area had some proportion of recanary grass in it. 6 years following restoration, we saw a wide scale conversion from these recanary grass dominated wetlands or wetlands with some recanary grass to complete sedge wetland where you know, I went out there and I couldn't find a recanary grass shoot anywhere here in this green area. And so we did calculate that as a 68% total reduction of the invasive grass at this McGregor Meadows WPA area. Here are some pictures pre-project. A lot of it wasn't recanary grass monoculture, but you know, most of it, you know, these are sedges with some proportion of recanary grass in there. 6 years post restoration, we saw this basically sea of sedges. Definitely, you know, pockets of recanary grass still holding on, but you know, in these vast sedge communities, nothing to be seen for recanary grass. Let's move to Lost Trail National Wildlife Refuge. This was restored in 2016 and 2017, included road relocation, creek restoration, drainage ditch fills, again, restoring groundwater levels in a previously ditched wetland environment. And we'll just focus on the large wetland complex directly south and east of the refuge headquarters. I don't know if you all have been there, but it's pretty cool. So this before restoration, Pleasant Valley Road was right here, and there were these large wetland drainage ditches along Pleasant Valley Road. We removed the road to upland locations, filled in these drainage ditches, and we saw an increase in total area from 52 acres of wetlands up to 143 acres of total wetland area. And you can see the 2014 wetland extent in this white dotted line, and 2020 wetland extent in the red. So it's a pretty drastic difference. And with this 2020 UAS imagery that we collected, you can really see this vast sedge community and some open water areas that also provide some great habitat for various waterfowl species. And you can see the difference in this picture versus this picture. There was definitely some sedge and rush communities in the middle of that pre-restoration, but post-restoration, it just really exploded in size, and we lost the vast majority of reed canary grass from that initial area. So 60% of pre-project reed canary grass in those wetlands were converted to native sedge and rush communities. 6% was converted to open water, and 93% of pre-project garrison creeping foxtail in the wetlands was also converted to native sedges and rushes. In this case, we did have, reed canary grass expansion to the outlying areas as well. However, the most interesting and most applicable part of this story to the Swan Project is that all this area, if you notice this boundary, the same boundary is here, all this yellow area was a complete conversion from reed canary grass to native sedges and rushes. So here we see some pictures. This was pre-project, and then even just 4 years post-project, we see this amazing result, conversion of the reed canary grass communities to sedges and nice open water features in between there. So with that, you all maybe haven't seen the environmental assessment, but it is available for public scoping from now through May 14th. It can be viewed on the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service website. Public comments can be submitted to Ben Gillis, the project leader, and then any specific design or assessment questions can be directed to Luke Lamar with Swan Valley Connections. And his email is down here.
All right, thanks, Lita. Again, if you have any questions, please type them in the Q&A box found at the bottom of your screen there. And I'll do my best to direct each question to the appropriate panelist. And we'll try and lump similar questions together if there are any. And if we get inundated with a bunch of questions, we may not be able to answer them all, but feel free to contact us after the presentation if you still have further questions. I see we have a couple questions already during the presentation, so we'll just start there. Question number one basically asks, will there be any access changes to Bog Road? And do you expect access to be made easier or more difficult following the project? So Jim, maybe that would be a question for you.
Sure, yeah, I can take a shot at it. I'm not sure, quite frankly. Bog Road, as you know, if you're a user out there, has really disintegrated over the years. Part of Bog Road, though, is the problem. I mean, it is a artificial feature. It's a road. So in restoring the hydrology, some of it is going to be altered, I imagine. But when we're done, we'll take a look at it, we'll reevaluate it, and then see what is left of it as far as a hiking trail for the public. A few years back in 2018, we acquired the Oxbow Preserve from the Nature Conservancy, and there's a really cool trail down there that we would like to get up and running in a little better shape, the Tolson Trail. And So if we are going to lose a little bit on Bog Road, as far as, you know, being able to access the west end of the refuge, we're certainly going to gain it on the southern part of the refuge on what used to be the Oxbow Preserve.
Great, thanks. Another question we have, what impact will a 1 foot increase in groundwater level have on downstream septic systems? So maybe Salita or maybe Wyatt can take a shot at that one. I assume they mean the questions being asked about the homes kind of on the northeast of the refuge there in the town of Swan Lake.
Yeah, I what's happening throughout the refuge is an increase in water surface level within the fringes of the refuge, being flanked by the Swan River to the west and then the road grade to the east. Any water that gets pushed up and to rehydrate this refuge will make its way back into the lake prior to reaching any private land. I can't imagine there's any septic systems in or close to the refuge. I'm pretty familiar with where the houses begin, so I can't foresee any sort of impact on septic systems from this project. The groundwater will eventually equalize as it reaches the lake, and it shouldn't crank back up beyond our construction extents where it flanks the lake.
Okay. Next question, is there a post-project monitoring plan to assess the actual response of vegetation over time? I can say from Swan Valley Connections standpoint, we'd be very interested in potentially monitoring that, but I'll refer that question to Jim as well.
Well, as we've done at McGregor Meadows and at Lost Trail, it's very valuable to us to look back and monitor these projects to determine how successful they are. So the short answer to that question is yes, we will keep track of it. It certainly has bearing on where we spend our money and on what projects going forward. So we definitely want to know how successful we are with big projects like this one.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One other question I think was mentioned is that the question is, will the road going into the current parking / viewing area with the kiosk be improved in addition to the expansion of the parking area? That was previously covered, and yet the answer is yes. The turnoff on the Highway 83 will be expanded to a 60 foot turning radius, as well as the parking area, to answer that question.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, most truck drivers I know like to have an easy path. So, you know, the contractor will have this everything improved, including the increased radii to where, you know, a large semi or side dump can access with ease. So once the project is complete, that'll leave a really nice access for the regular car, truck, vehicle passage.
Okay, one thing we never covered, I guess, so good question, is there an optimal time frame when we would do this work from start to finish? Jim or Salita?
Sure. Go ahead, Salita.
I was just going to say that, you know, it depends on the water year and when the water recedes and when we can actually start working. But we anticipate, you know, starting in August. Is that right, Jim?
Yep.
And then Nate, it would continue for probably 3 months. Is that the time frame?
Yes, I believe. Yeah, eight to 12 weeks.
And hopefully this year, yeah.
Yep.
If things go well.
Yeah. So the ultimate goal is to do it in one field season if possible. Someone asked, where will the fill come from to fill the ditches on Horseshoe Marsh? Which, if everyone isn't familiar with what Horseshoe Marsh is, it's that old oxbow on the west side of the river that has the two ditches draining it.
Yep, that's a great question.
I'll refer to Salita or Wyatt on that one.
Nate Wyatt.
Nate.
it is. Yeah, we're talking about these. These ones, right?
Correct.
Yeah. So originally we had, you know, we were looking at these, the rock dikes that are there right now. We ended up leaving those in place in the design. And right now, Nate, correct me if I'm wrong, but we have that material coming from the inside of this wetland area. Is that right?
Yes, we're gonna create an open water feature and use that material to fill primary five, essentially. So we're just gonna flip-flop that material, plug it to floodplain elevation, and create an open water feature that'll yeah. stand.
Nate, for primary six and primary seven, I believe the since it's not a historical rock weir or anything, and it doesn't, you know, I think right now this rock weir is used for accessing the river. I believe the primary six and seven, we're just going to use the on-site material, the original ditch spoil berm. Is that right, Nate?
That's correct. So essentially most of the material that was excavated to build the ditches is still existing adjacent to the ditch. So we'll just use that same material. And if we need to supplement more, we can we'll go ahead and open it up slightly. Those open water features to make that plug work without any additional hauling.
Okay. Another question that has come in here. Salita mentioned that the reed canary grass mats or certain mats would be put back over the fill on the ditches once that's in place.
Yeah.
So I think the question is, would after doing that, would those areas still be wet enough to drown out that those reed canary grass mats that you would install back in there?
Yeah, I think definitely on the northern end of the refuge, where we have the higher groundwater levels. You know, and reusing those sod mats, that really helps in the short term for erosion control, especially on those ditch plugs. We need those ditch plugs to be solid and stable. So in the northern areas, you know, we do expect that, you know, over time they will get drowned out. In the southern locations where it's just, you know, reed canary grass monoculture and it's just surrounded by more and more reed canary grass, it'll probably be reed canary grass. Does that answer that question?
We'll hope so. And if that person needs more clarification, just type that in.
Yeah, it's definitely reducing the risk of erosion in the short term, you know, especially before any seed that we put down can establish. So.
And then we had a point, question of clarification on project implementation window, asking if that's 2021. The answer is yes, if all goes well and everything comes together by this summer or fall. The goal is for implementation to happen in 2021. Another question is, can you speak to the potential for increased oxygenation of Swan Lake? Just a little background on this question. The Swan Lakers monitor water quality in Swan Lake and in the South Bay, which is the deepest part of Swan Lake, I believe. They get 0% dissolved oxygen in the bottom of South Bay in certain autumns. And so I think probably to rearrange the question, maybe, is this project going to help that potential dissolved oxygen issue? Who wants to take a stab at that one?
Well, I can say that we can certainly look into that. The increased oxygenation didn't really come up just due to the velocity of the water that we're introducing, ground surface to groundwater interaction, the oxygenation of the lake. I can't foresee a huge difference, but that's a really good question, and we can certainly investigate that a little more, see if there is actually any impact, and we'll get back to you on that.
You know, I'll take a shot at it by restoring the filtration of that natural floodplain adjacent to the lake. I think you're going to hold a lot more nitrates, phosphates, and decomposing matter, even just by reducing the tonnage of reed canary grass that is produced out there every year, dies down, and then the next May flood takes it out into the lake, settles to the bottom. That's going to use up oxygen as it decomposes. So, you know, obviously I'm no expert, but I think it's going to help that issue. It just makes sense to me that it would help that issue. So that's where I'm putting my money.
Yeah, I agree, Jim. I think that's it'll be interesting to monitor that over time, post-restoration, to see if there's any effects there. But I would imagine they'd be positive effects and no negative ones towards that. Another question, is there a concern that filling the ditch at the rock dike, which for folks who don't know where that is on the west side of the refuge where there's a little recreational access. Is there any concern that filling the ditch at the rock dike, that the river bank in the ditch will blow out due to excess water, as there is no outlet there if the rock dike is left in place?
Yeah, you know, I mean, the current condition, in its current condition, the water does overtop that rock dike a portion of the year. I don't think there's much of a chance of increased risk there. Nate, maybe you can talk a little bit more.
Yeah, you know, when we're out there, basically there is a section that kind of acts as a weir, and I know that some of the downstream owners may use that, or at least count on that water. So it actually functions as an existing weir during the, it looks like it's been stable for many, many years. So any major flood events that may have happened, certainly I've not disturbed that rock weir, and I don't foresee plugging any ditches and adding any increased volume should have any effect on the weir. That should continue to be stable.
Okay, another question that we have here, and it might be site specific, but we have a question that asks, have you identified a water level threshold for drowning reed canary grass?
Yeah, that's definitely what we try to tease out. You know, if we look at, pardon me going through these slides real quick, you know, if we see this groundwater 6 plot, and that's shown in this blue, as well as the yellow groundwater 8. The groundwater 8's a little different story. It is associated with some, you know, greater than 50% recurring grass, I think. But here in the very northern locations where we generally have the higher groundwater levels, there is no recurring grass here or here or here. So there's a threshold somewhere in there. And we, you know, if we're just looking at this 1 year of data, but I would say if it's completely inundated for all of the growing season, I think it's drowned out. Yeah, I'm not gonna put an actual threshold on it. It's one of those species where it's been studied a lot, and there's all kinds of variables in its life cycle. So like I said, we're pretty confident that we can reduce the occurrence of reed canary grass in these native sedge and rush communities right in through here. So basically shifting, you know, looking at these areas without any reed canary grass, and hopefully that'll spread south to about here. So sorry, I don't have an actual number on that for you. But.
Okay, I kind of skipped over one question a while back. I'll ask it. I'm not entirely sure if I totally understand what is being asked, but question is, can you compare the efficacy of raising the water table by flooding above the ground level versus creating more meandering in the stream or riverbed? Both seem to reduce reed canary grass, as a comment at the end of that. I think what the question is asking is, instead of plugging the ditches, can we create meanders in some of those old river or stream channels instead to access the floodplain?
So maybe instead of plugging the ditches, making them more into meandering stream channels?
I think maybe that's the question, but if that person wants to clarify that, please chime back in there.
Yeah. You know, in this system, with when we're when we, you know, analyze this whole landscape, these drainage ditches were built just to drain the wetland hydrology. In some other instances, you know, drainage ditches can be old historical channels. In that case, you know, you may want to restore the channels to a nice meandering geometry. In this case, because these are actual wetland drains, and they didn't function before as channels.
Looking at the big picture, the whole goal of the project is, you know, to restore it back to its natural setting. Naturally, Swan River migrated across this valley back and forth. There wasn't really a natural spring creek setting. And to achieve, since the reed canary grass was introduced, one of the goals is to remove that, introducing a stream. You could raise the groundwater by doing that, but I think the most beneficial way to approach this is what we're doing is to just restore the surface water during these months. So it would be an option, but I think with the goals of this project, it's not really applicable.
Yeah, that same individual chimed back in and gave an example. Projects like Odell Spring Creek achieved 4 feet or more. By reducing channelization, improving native grasses, and
yeah, definitely. And then in the Odell Creek example, those ditches were historical stream channels, historically they were nice, you know, and we did a huge LIDAR analysis there too, and you know, we've been restoring that whole ecosystem, including, you know, like almost 900 acres of wetlands out there through, you know, raising that ground that water level from the ditched environment up to the surface, and reconnecting those old floodplain features to the creek. And that's a bit different of a system than here, where, you know, like Nate was alluding to, the Swan River has, you know, migrated and meandered back and forth through history. But these wetland drainage ditches, there were never stream channels to begin with.
Okay, thanks. A couple more questions here. I'm gonna break this one up. If the water level gets higher, is there concern for the reed canary grass advancing up to higher ground in the riparian zone?
Yeah, and that's definitely a valid question too. And we did look at that, you know, looking at the, and analyzing the occurrence of reed canary grass throughout the whole refuge, sorry about this, and how much is really there. You know, there's some locations where when you get into these more shrubland and forested areas where you have, you know, you don't have canary grass, but then you have canary grass popping up in areas that are actually lower in elevation. So they're getting access to that groundwater. You know, there is the possibility that canary grass could kind of encroach into these areas, but then I think that is also somewhat mitigated by the canopy cover of the shrubs and the forested areas. You know, canary grass likes a lot of light, and if you have, it's been shown that if you have a diverse canopy cover, not a whole lot of light goes into the ground, and canary grass, it's not the ideal environment, I guess, for canary grass. But you know, looking back at the example I gave for Lost Trail, you know, where we saw expansion of that canary grass kind of towards the outskirts of the wetland area, it's a little different here because we already have reed canary grass in the vast majority of wetland area. In the entirety of the valley bottom. So short answer is yes, it's definitely a possibility. But I think the benefit to the reduction of canary grass far outweighs that possibility.
Okay, and then the second part of that question was regarding the timing of the project, and if it goes into the fall, are there concerns that the heavy equipment will create excessive soil compaction or harm to native plant communities?
Well, that's a great question. That for a majority of the internal roads that we're using, will be traveling across the existing berms. So as we remove those berms, it'll be reclaimed, so we won't really be impacting anything that's not already impacted at that point. And then the additional roads that we're constructing, you know, there's definitely going to be some compaction. There'll be fabric and about a foot of road base, and that'll be traveled on. So when they reclaim that, the excavators typically will unconsolidate that with their bucket as they leave, and we'll reseed it and or let all that vegetation reestablish. I mean, an environment like this, you just leave a bare surface for, you know, a growing season, it fills right in. So we're not too concerned about compaction, but we're going to minimize that as much as possible. That's a good point.
I was going to say, we have very well-defined access routes and in areas where it's not, you know, the tops of berms and levees, we have very well-defined, you know, one track, you know, access routes. So we won't be tracking all over the wetlands, the nice existing wetlands out there.
Great. Well, I think we covered all the questions that have been asked so far. We ended with a comment that said, you guys are awesome. Fantastic work. Thank you. So that might be a fitting way to wrap this presentation up, unless there's any other questions that come in. There was also a comment from Tom Bansack, who I believe is a board member with the Swan Lakers. And does a lot of the water quality monitoring on Swan Lake. So I'll just read what he said, that slowing down the water flow through the refuge by filling the ditches will result in the processing of more organic material and result in less carbon going out into the lake. Carbon decomposition will likely cause the dissolved oxygen, carbon decomposition likely causes the dissolved oxygen sag in Swan Lake. And he thinks this project will help with that dissolved oxygen issue, but we will see. Yep. So just wanted to throw that in there.
All right.
We had one more question. And that question is there any particular interest to monitor if or how this project changes or affects the distribution of beavers throughout the project area?
That's an interesting question. We'll probably have to get back to you on that one. So far, I haven't seen any studies on beavers in the area. Have you, Jim?
No. Yeah, that's a really interesting question. I guess I don't really know how to respond to it. Riparian shrub community is really indicative of how many, what type of beaver population can be supported along the Swan River or any of its tributaries. So they certainly move in and out of those areas, and any given year when they find the environment they like, they tend to occupy it. So I don't know specifically how this project would affect those populations.
Okay, thanks. And I don't see any other questions, so I think we'll wrap it up with that. I'd like to thank all of our panelists for their time and good work in crafting this exciting restoration project, and to all the audience members for participating. Again, this presentation will be recorded and available on Swan Valley Connections website soon, if anyone has friends they'd like to share it with who couldn't make it this evening. And if folks want to submit any public comments for the project, again, you have until May 15th to do so. And if there's any other further questions, you can refer to those to Ben at the on the screen there. You can see his contact info, or myself, and if we can't answer him, we'll pass him along to Salita or Nate or others. So thanks again, Salita, Jim, Nate, and Ben, for joining us.
Awesome. And thank you.
Good evening.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good.